Cheers, everyone. I hope you're enjoying the time with your church family, and I'm excited about today and looking forward to all that this year is going to bring for us. And today, for just a few minutes, I want to talk to you about how to get the most out of 2012. I mean, can you really believe that 2011 is really over? You know, for a lot of people, it was a very tough year, but the good news is today, we get to start over. God brings life to us in little bite-sized pieces, and every year he just says, let's just wipe the slate clean and start over, and it's called a brand new year, and that's good news. Now, I don't want you to do this year like the lady who was taking a nap, an afternoon nap on New Year's Eve, and after she woke up, she told her husband, I had this dream that you gave me a diamond ring for a New Year's Day present. What do you think all that means? And he says, aha, you'll know tonight. And at midnight, as New Year's was chiming in, he handed her this small package, and she was so excited, and she opened it quickly, and there in her hand was this book entitled, The Meaning of Dreams. You know, we often start our New Year off with dreams, big dreams, only to get to the end of the year and be disappointed by what's happened. So my question for you this morning is, how will 2012 be better than last year? The key is this. You've got to have a plan. It's got to be more than just a dream. You can't say, I hope this is going to be better. You've got to have a plan to actually make it better. Now here's what Proverbs chapter 17, verse 24 says. An intelligent person aims at wise actions, but a fool starts off in many different directions. Do you have a plan for 2012? Or are you just walking into this year hoping that it's going to be better? Today, I want to give you four very quick steps on how to get the most out of this new year. The first one is this. Assume responsibility for your life. We've all got to assume responsibility for our own lives. Now, this is not really a popular concept because we have in our culture this concept that basically says none of your problems are your fault. You know, blame the environment, blame the educator, blame your parents, blame the government. But because it's not your fault. You know, if the coffee's too hot, sue someone. It's their fault. But you're never going to be successful if you have that attitude. You've got to assume responsibility for your own life. Here's what the Bible says in Galatians chapter 6, verse 5. Each person must be responsible for himself. Now, not one of us can control the circumstances that are going to happen to us in the next 365 days. But we can control our actions and our reactions to what happens to us. You know, there's three types of people in life. There are accusers, and those are the people who blame everybody else. There are excusers, and those are the people who procrastinate in everything. And then there are people that I call choosers, who say, I'm choosing to accept responsibility for my life and my happiness. And if you can do that, you're already a jump ahead in 2012. So assume responsibility for my own life. The second thing is this. Believe that you can. You know, stop saying I can't and start saying I can. The person who says I can't and the person who says I can, unfortunately, both end up being right. Philippians chapter 4, verse 13 says, there's nothing I cannot master with the help of Christ who gives me the strength. Now, do you believe that? There's nothing that you can't master. That means there's nothing that's going to hit in the next 365 days. No problem, no situation, no circumstance, no hassle that I can't handle, that I can't manage, that I'm not going to be able to handle. I mean, on my own effort? Well, of course not. But with the strength that Christ gives me is what it says. I'm not talking about positive thinking here. I'm talking about God's supernatural power in our lives. You're not just psyching yourself up and saying, I think I can, I think I can, I think I can, because there are some things in your life that no matter how much you think you can, you can't. I mean, I'd like to think that I can be 7 feet tall and play in the NBA, but I can't. You see, there's a difference between self-help and Christianity. There's a lot of good self-help books out there that tell you what to do. They just don't give you the power to do it. And that's why we need Jesus Christ to succeed in this new year. So first, we've got to accept the responsibility of our own life. And then, you've got to believe that you've got the power to do it if you'll trust Him. Now, here's the third step into having and getting the most out of 2012. And that is, be clear about what you really want. You've got to decide what's important and what's not important in your life. God has given us this incredible gift. It's called the freedom of choice. And it's one of the ways that we're different from all of God's creations. Look at this verse in Job. It says, we can choose the sounds we want to listen to. We can choose the taste we want in food. We should choose to follow what is right. But first of all, we must define what is good. That means we've got to be clear about what we really want. You know what? It's amazing, but most people never do this. They never stop and think through and write down on paper what's really important to them, what really counts. You can't do what's important until you're really clear about what you feel like is important. Your values will determine your vision. You stop and say, what's important? What really matters most to me? You know, this week I'm going to ask you to set aside a block of time, maybe an hour or so, and sit down and write down two things on a piece of paper. First of all, what do I value? What do I value? And write it down. Is it worth spending part of your life to figure out what is important to you? I think so. The second thing is, what do I want to change? And then you've got to believe that you can change it. But first, you've got to pinpoint what it is that you want to change. And then I would encourage you to take this. I challenge you to take this. Make this your prayer list. Make this your list of goals. Put it up on a wall and review it every day. Pray about it. And then watch God accomplish things in your life that you didn't think you could actually accomplish. But be clear about what you really want. And then number four, don't wait to get started. Do it now. Three words that will change your life. Do it now. There will never be an ideal circumstance or an ideal time to start with this change or what you want to accomplish, to make some certain growth or to work on that development. You've got to do it now. Here's what Ecclesiastes 11:4 says. If you wait for perfect conditions, you'll never get anything done. You know, probably the phrase I hear more than anything else is, when things settle down, then I'll, and they fill in the blank. Well, can I just tell you, things are not going to settle down, because this is called life. And if you're using that as an excuse, if you use that excuse, then you're never going to get those things done, because life is not going to settle down. You know, when things settle down, I'm going to start doing this every single day. Well, then you're not going to do it. When things settle down, I'm going to spend more time with my kids. Well, guess what? They'll be grown and gone before you spend time with them. Because honestly, that's probably when life begins to settle down. I'm going to reestablish connection with my husband and wife. We're going to work on our romance. If you wait for things to settle down, your love life will die. Life has to be enjoyed during imperfect circumstances. So whatever you're going to do, get on with it now, because things are not going to settle down. Did you know that less than 5% of Americans have written down goals for their life? And a survey shows that the 5% who do are also the top 5% wage earners in America, in our culture. That means those that set goals have a greater income. It's just a proven fact. Why? They know what they want in life. Now, interesting, some of you just got a little more motivated to spend some time writing these things down. Ken Blanchard says that when you set goals, they need to be SMART goals. And here's what SMART stands for. S stands for be specific. Vague goals have no power. M means motivational. If it doesn't motivate you, don't do it, because don't set the goal, because you're not even going to try. It has to be obtainable. If you can't reach the goal, you're just going to get discouraged and quit trying. It has to be relevant. You know what that means? That means it has to be based on your values, what you feel like is important. Don't ever set a goal that you think somebody else thinks you ought to set. And then the T in SMART stands for trackable. That means I can measure my progress. Now, how do I know if I've reached my goals? Some of you are already thinking, oh, you know what, this whole goal thing, this resolution thing, I've gone that route. I've done the New Year's resolution route, and it lasts 2 weeks. I set goals, but I just don't follow through. I've got all these great intentions every year, but I just don't stick with it. I don't have the power to do it. And that's exactly right. You would be right in saying that. And that's why we need God's help. On a moment-by-moment basis, especially on a day like today where we're launching into a brand new year. You see, again, that's the difference from self-help psychology and Christianity. The books tell you the right things to do, but they don't give you the power to do it. Only God can give you the power to do it. Only God can give you the power to follow through. I want you to get the most out of 2012, personally. I want us as a church to get the most out of it as well. That's why next weekend I'll be starting a brand new series on this very topic called Wiki Church. I'm so excited about this. It's going to be powerful. And I want us to get the most out of this new year. You know, it's four ways we can do that. I hope you'll take these and you'll apply them as you look at your new year as a fresh start, a clean slate. I know God has great things for you this year, and I want you to accomplish them all. Would you pray with me? Father, we're so grateful to be in this new year. I'm so excited about all that you're going to do. I'm so excited about Rock Point Church and every individual who makes it up. God, you've created us for more, and we're ready for more. It's going to be an exciting year. And God, I'm so excited about what you're going to do. Please help us to do our part by taking steps forward and believing and being clear and trusting that you can give us the power to accomplish all that we've decided to do, all that you've called us to do. God, we'll trust you this year. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, Happy New Year, everyone. Enjoy your time together.